Now, this is an old car battery of mine, but why does that matter? Well, some time ago, a viewer sent me a link to a YouTube video. In it, someone took an old lead-acid battery with little capacity left, built a magic circuit for it, which he then slapped onto it for 30 days, and afterwards, the battery got allegedly revived with close to its original capacity. For me, that all sounds too good to be true. And there were actually two big things in the video which made me question whether it is real or fake. The first one, and most obvious one, was that the capacity of the battery never got measured, neither before nor after using the magic circuits. And secondly, in the creator schematic and finished PCB design, you can find a resistor that is connected to absolutely nothing, which made me question whether he knew what he was doing. So in this video, I will put a circuit and this battery revival technique to the test, which of course includes proper capacity measurements and own designs to ultimately declare what is real and what is fake. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by the Altium Designer Software and JLC PCB, who are a perfect match when it comes to designing PCBs and then actually ordering them. But more about them later. Now, first off, this method of reviving batteries is called desulfation, and it is limited to lead acid batteries, which you can find in your car, motorcycle, or even alarm systems as a backup battery. You can find tons of information about desulfation and opinions about whether it works or not on the internet. But to summarize it briefly, we can say that when discharging a lead acid battery, lead sulfates accumulate on the plate electrodes. Do not worry though, because when charging up the battery, those sulfates disappear. But if your battery got not used for a long time, got discharged too much, or had to handle big temperature differences, then those sulfate crystals on the plates can increase in size and stay there permanently, which decreases the current the battery can output and also, more importantly, its capacity. To solve this problem, people came up with the Desulfator circuit that, in a nutshell, creates high current pulses that breaks down the crystals and removes them from the plates. And with the initial theory out of the way, I wanted to firstly see what my old car battery can still output. So I charged it up to 14.8 volts with my lab bench power supply. And in case you're wondering, that is pretty much the max voltage you should charge a lead acid battery with. I also set the max current to 7 amps, which is 1/10 of the original capacity. And that is a pretty good rule of thumb when it comes to carefully charging or discharging. But anyway, as charging was going on, I sensed that something was wrong, because it took forever for the charge current to settle down, the battery was getting a bit warm on the outside, and the initial voltage of 10.3 volts only increased up to 11.4 volts and was dropping quickly. Needless to say, this battery could no longer output any significant current, meaning there was nothing that could revive it, and thus I had to replace it with two other lead acid batteries I had laying around. After fully charging them up the same way as I described it before, and then using a constant load to discharge them while simultaneously calculating their capacity, it seems like the big battery came with a real capacity of 23.94 amp hours, while it originally featured 44 amp hours, and the small one only 2.345 amp hours, while originally 4.5 amp hours. In both cases, that is around half of the original capacity, and since they've been standing around most of the time doing nothing, they should be perfect candidates for desulfator circuits, right? To find that out, I firstly recreated the schematic of the desulfator circuit from the video, in order to understand how it functions. And luckily for me, it is built around a 555 timer IC, about which I already made a basics video that you can check out for more information. But simply put, the 555 timer outputs a rectangle waveform on its output, whose frequency and on/off time gets set by these two resistors and one capacitor. Of course, you could calculate all of that on paper, but for more fun, I simply built this 555 timer circuit up in mid-air to determine that it creates a rectangle waveform with a frequency of 1.22 kHz and an off time of 35 microseconds. In this case, the off time is more important, because that is the time the used p-channel MOSFET is turned on in the schematic, meaning current can flow through it. When that is happening, current also flows through these two coils, who not only now let the current rise slowly, but they also build up a magnetic field around them. And as soon as the MOSFET turns off, aka the rectangle waveform switches to high, the energy of the magnetic field of the coils now gets used to still pump current through the circuits. But the only way to go now is to the battery, and that is how the current pulse gets created. To test this, I built up this exact circuit in mid-air, and after connecting it to a battery, nothing exploded. And you can now clearly hear the 1 kHz hum of the coils, meaning our current pulse got created successfully. That means the circuit from the video is real, and does a job like intended. But maybe it is not a completely original circuit, because after doing some research, I found the resistor the video creator used incorrectly, and normally it is used to add a bit of resistance between the 555 timer and the power part of the circuit. But nevertheless, even though this circuit works, I wanted to create a more powerful version of it, which means I needed to adjust the rectangle waveform. And while I was at it, I also wanted to add a switch to separately turn off the power electronics and also utilize an N-channel MOSFET instead of a P-channel one. So with those ideas in mind, I created my own version of the circuit with the Altium Designer software, which was quick and easy to do. And while I was at it, I also created a PCB design for the circuit, to make things easier for me later on. And through the help of Altium 365, I could also upload my design to the cloud to access it everywhere and share it easily. So if you want to try that out as well, then check the video description below. Okay, the next step was of course then uploading my design to JLC PCB, to order my professional PCBs for very low price, which, like always, arrived within a week and looked gorgeous. Currently they offer 1-8 layer PCBs for only $2, and even their 1-20 layer PCB assembly service also comes with $24 coupons, so definitely check them out as well. And with that being said, it was time to add all the components to my board, solder them in place, and ultimately take it for a test ride, only to find out that I made a big mistake. You see, since I'm now using an N-channel MOSFET, the on time of the waveform turns the MOSFET on, and that is problematic, because in this 555 timer configuration, the on time can only be above 50% of the duty cycle. Sounds a bit complicated, but it basically only means that the MOSFET stays on for too long, and thus too much current flows through the coils. To fix that, I had to come up with a little logic level inverter circuit, which looks something like this in the schematic. With it, the on time of the MOSFET once again gets dictated by the off time of the waveform, and thus, as you can hear, everything now works perfectly fine. And since the on time is quite a bit longer than the original circuit ones, it not only draws a bit more current in direct comparison, but its current pulses are also more powerful. And that brings me to my 30-day experiment with the two batteries, in which I only had to wait and daily charge up the small battery. As soon as the 30 days were over, I charged up the batteries once more and, as you would have expected it, discharged them with the constant loads. And the result of the smaller battery was that the capacity stayed pretty much around the same. And for the bigger battery, it was pretty much the same deal. Bummer. Now please, don't start complaining that my circuit is the problem here. Because I actually also tried out commercial desulfator circuits I got from Amazon. The first one pretty much works the same way as my DIY one, but the second one seems to use a higher frequency. So I did another test with them for 2 weeks, but sadly, the results were even worse this time, because the capacity of both batteries apparently shrank noticeably. I'm not entirely sure why, but I have to accept this result, meaning that all in all, this circuit from the video was real, but according to my tests and experiments, desulfation is not, at least according to my results. But feel free to believe whatever you want, and keep in mind to be respectful in the comment section. With that being said, I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something new. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!